Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted to have you join us. As you may know by now, we are studying the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This series is for the third quarter, that is the months of July, August, and September of 2014. It's entitled The Teachings of Jesus, and this particular lesson is lesson number 6 in that series for August 9 of 2014, entitled Growing in Christ. It's a very significant lesson, and it spends quite a bit of time talking about the conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus is found in John 3 of your Bible. So hopefully by now you've got a Bible handy. Maybe you have it memorized. In any case, let's pray together as we study this lesson. Our kind and wonderful Father, we thank you for these insights into your time when you were here as an individual, as a human being on this earth. We wish we could be there and or have a video of the conversation you had with Nicodemus, but let us in imagination go now and learn what we can from the brief report we have in the gospel. May we come to be more like you through this intimate acquaintance is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Look at John 3, 1-15, and I'm going to take time to just read most of that right now, but because it's central to this lesson. There was a Jewish leader named Nicodemus. Now, I'm going to stop for just a second and ask you some questions. This is an interesting situation because what kind of word is Nicodemus? Where did that name come from?
Is it Greek?
It's a Greek name. It's a Greek name. But he belonged to the party of the Pharisees. One night he went to Jesus and said to him, Rabbi, now we're going to ask questions, of course, what's he doing coming at night?
Afraid to be seen.
Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher sent by God. No one can perform the miracles you are doing unless God were with him. Jesus answered, I'm telling you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born again. How can a grown man be born again, Nicodemus asked. He certainly can't enter his mother's womb and be born a second time. I am telling you the truth, replied Jesus. No one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. A person is born physically of human parents, but is born spiritually of the Spirit. Do not be surprised because I tell you that you must all be born again. The wind blows wherever it wishes. You hear the sound it makes, but you do not know where it comes from or where it is going. I guess the weatherman might argue with that a little bit. It is like that with everyone who is born of the Spirit. How can this be? Asked Nicodemus. Jesus answered, You are a great teacher in Israel and you don't know this? I am telling you the truth. We speak of what we know and report what we have seen, yet none of you is willing to accept our message. You do not believe me when I tell you all the things about the things in this world. How will you ever believe me then when I tell you about the things of heaven? And no one has ever gone up to heaven except the Son of Man who came down from heaven. As Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the desert, in the same way the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. And of course it's followed by that famous verse that probably all of us have learned, John 3:16. So, Nicodemus was a man who was held in high esteem because of his generosity in supporting the temple and his role in the Sanhedrin. These are just some ideas I gathered from Ellen White. He had heard John the Baptist preaching beyond the Jordan. He was upset by the profiteering going on in the temple courtyard. He was attracted by the preaching and the demeanor of that rabbi from Galilee. He wondered if Jesus could be the Messiah. But he knew that if he approached Jesus openly, it would raise lots of questions and might jeopardize his position in the Sanhedrin. So he sought an opportunity to interview Jesus at night. What do you think about that? Does it bother you at all?
It may have been wise.
I am too good a man to talk to God during the daytime, so I'll talk to him at night.
You don't want to jeopardize his position?
Yeah.
Well, Jesus seemed to be okay with it.
Yeah.
Didn't say anything about it.
We're gonna read why it was probably a good idea as we move on here. When they met, Nicodemus greeted Jesus very respectfully. Jesus recognized that this was not a time for casual greetings. So what does Jesus do? He just jumps straight into it, doesn't he? He said to Nicodemus, it is not theoretical knowledge you need so much as spiritual regeneration. You need to have your curiosity. You need not to have your curiosity just satisfied, but to have a new heart. You must receive a new life from above before you can appreciate heavenly things. Until this change takes place, making all things new, it will result in no saving good for you to discuss with me my authority and my mission. Doesn't that sound kind of blunt? Why was Jesus so blunt?
Well, maybe the writer was blunt because he didn't have enough time, enough room in the his paper to write.
It might not have been. Well, I suppose it's possible, yeah.
Time was probably short. And mm-hmm. He knew he was dealing with an intelligent man. Why beat about the bush?
Yeah.
This was no peasant who had something.
No. Nicodemus had heard the preaching of John the Baptist concerning repentance and baptism, and pointing the people to the one who should baptize with the Holy Spirit. He himself had felt, this is Nicodemus, had felt that there was a lack of spirituality among the Jews, that to a great degree they were controlled by bigotry and worldly ambition. This guy's got a fair amount of insight, right? He had hoped for a better state of things at the Messiah's coming. Yet the heart-searching message of the Baptist had failed to work in him conviction of sin. All that wonderful preaching from John the Baptist, and he didn't think he needed any help. Why not? He was a descendant of Abraham, and he was a Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin. I mean, how can you get any better than that, right? He didn't need any help. Well, she says he was a strict Pharisee and prided himself on his good works. He was widely esteemed for his benevolence and his liberality in sustaining the temple service, and he felt secure of the favor of God. He was startled at the thought of a kingdom too pure for him to see in his present state. Think about that for a moment. He thought he was good enough, right, just the way he was, to enter heaven. But by virtue of his birth as an Israelite, he regarded himself as sure of a place in the kingdom of God. He felt that he needed no change, hence his surprise at the Savior's words. He was irritated by their close application to himself. I mean, you aren't talking to me. If you've forgotten who I am, I'm a Pharisee, I'm a member of the Sanhedrin, and I'm Nicodemus. Right? He felt that he needed no change, hence his surprise at the Savior's words. He was irritated. We already read that. The pride of the Pharisee was struggling against the honest desire of the seeker after truth. He wondered that Jesus should speak to him as he did, not respecting his position as a ruler in Israel. Desire of Ages 171, paragraphs 1 to 3. We need to sort of keep this in general terms and not get too personal. Have any of you ever experienced what it's like to have the pride of the Pharisee struggle with the honest desire of the seeker after truth?
What was that question again?
I mean, we're Adventists, right? We have the truth.
Somebody from outside the church could teach us something?
Well, I'm on the bus. I mean, it's headed for the kingdom, isn't it? What more do I need?
You aren't suggesting that there could be some even Seventh-day Adventist pastors or teachers that... No, you weren't suggesting that.
Well, Nicodemus was thrown off his guard. He certainly did not expect to have this humble Galilean challenge his most precious beliefs. So what was Jesus actually asking Nicodemus to do? Maybe before I read what Ellen White says, think about it. What was Jesus actually asking Nicodemus to do?
change his paradigm.
Change. Get your mind off your own perfection.
Change the way you think, right? The fountain of the heart must be purified before the streams can become pure. He who is trying to reach heaven by his own works in keeping the law is attempting an impossibility. Do you remember some words that Ellen White said around about the year 1888 about the condition of the Adventist Church? We have preached the law, until we are as dry as the hills of Gilboa. Oh, yeah. With neither dew nor rain, right? Let me read this again. He who is trying to reach heaven by his own works in keeping the law is attempting an easy task? No, an impossibility. There is no safety for one who has merely a legal religion, a form of godliness. What's a legal religion?
Done by the rules.
Yep.
Someone who believes by legally, carefully observing the Ten Commandments, for example, you can earn your way to heaven. You can guarantee yourself a place in heaven, right?
Like the tithe-paying, Sabbath-keeping, health-reforming Adventist that crucified Jesus and ran out to keep the Sabbath?
Yeah. That's the right thing to do, right? The Christian's life, she goes on to say, is not a modification or improvement of the old, but a transformation of nature. How does that happen? We talked about this last week, but we need to keep nailing this down. We do not make those changes ourselves. How do they happen? We allow the Holy Spirit into our lives. We read the scriptures. We read the writings of Ellen White. We think about it. We pray to God. All that time, what are we doing? We're giving God access to our brains. And what does He do? Transforms our thinking. There is death to self and sin and a new life altogether. This change can be brought about only by the effectual working of the Holy Spirit. Desire of Ages, page 172, paragraph 1. So, now this transformation, Jesus called it what?
Born again.
To be born again, a new life, right? A new birth. Being born again does not yield itself to technical analysis. Some 60 years after this interview and under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, John used the Greek word pneuma, which can mean either wind or spirit, to describe what needs to happen. In either case, we can see the effects of the wind or of the spirit, but we cannot see the cause. So what about it? Do you think you can see the effects of the Spirit in people's lives? Can you see the effects of the Spirit in your own life? Well, let's go back to our story. Do you think Nicodemus really believed that he needed a new heart?
I think he got it sorted out in the end, but it took a long time.
Probably not at the beginning, right?
He might have been a little disturbed, but...
Needed 3 years.
Yeah.
Was he changed by that conversation?
Eventually.
What do you think he was thinking as he went home that night? Do you think he slept that night?
Probably not.
Could it be that his descent from Abraham and his position as a Pharisee and a member of the Sanhedrin did not guarantee him a place in heaven? For 3 years, Nicodemus mulled over these ideas from that night conference, but already he was being changed. And I quote, "In a council of the Sanhedrin, when the course to be pursued toward Jesus was considered, Nicodemus advised caution and moderation." I wonder if they had any idea that he had been having a conference with Jesus. He urged that if Jesus was really invested with authority from God, it would be perilous to reject his warnings. The priest dare not disregard, when we talk about the priest, what group are we talking about now?
Sadducees.
The Sadducees. The Sadducees dared not disregard this counsel, and for the time they took no open measures against the Savior. So what is Nicodemus actually doing already?
Protecting Christ.
Helping to protect Christ, right? Since hearing Jesus, Nicodemus had anxiously studied the prophecies relating to the Messiah, and the more he searched, the stronger was the conviction this was the one who was to come. So what's happening in Nicodemus's life?
He's turning it around.
Yeah.
Go back to the basics.
He's doing his homework. He's listening. And as he's studying the Bible, what's happening in his head?
Changing.
Being changed. Yep. The more he searched, the stronger was his conviction that this was the one who was to come. We say the one who was to come, who is he talking about?
Messiah.
The Messiah. With many others in Israel, he had been greatly distressed by the profanation of the temple. He was a witness of the scene when Jesus drove out the buyers and the sellers. He beheld the wonderful manifestation of divine power. He saw the Savior receiving the poor and healing the sick. He saw their looks of joy and heard their words of praise, and he could not doubt that Jesus of Nazareth was the sent of God. Desire of Ages 167 and 168. I want to take you there for a moment, and I want you to remind you of some things here. It's found, the story is found in John chapter 2. Jesus goes to the temple, starts in verse 13. Now, and I want you to think about this, because I'm going to ask you a question when I get to the end of the story. It was almost time for the Passover festival, so Jesus went to Jerusalem. There in the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and pigeons, and also the money changers sitting at their tables. Now, where were they sitting? What part of the temple?
In the courtyard.
Courtyard for the Gentiles.
They were sitting in the courtyard that was supposed to be the place open for Gentiles to come and learn about how the Jews worshiped. And how many Gentiles were learning anything about how they worshiped in that courtyard?
It's the biggest protection racket they ever had.
What?
Learning how to make money.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, if they were even allowed in there, for that matter. Well, so he made a whip from cords and drove all the animals out of the temple. What's he doing with the whip with cords?
Driving out the animals.
Driving out the animals. Does it sound like he used the whip on any people? People will tell you, yes, Jesus got angry once. He got a cord and he was beating people. No, that's not what he was doing. He was driving out the animals, right? Both the sheep and the cattle, he overturned the tables of the money changers and scattered their coins, and he ordered those who sold the pigeons, take them out of here, stop making my father's house a marketplace. Okay. Why were there money changers in the temple?
People from all over the world, the then known world, came in.
And?
The exchange rate was heavily in favor of the temple.
Well, because the shekel could be used only in the temple. So they could set their own rate, whatever rate they wanted. Extract as much. They were charging enormous exchange rates, you know.
They'd bring their sacrificial offerings, their animals, and they'd be inspected, and they say, those aren't good enough, so you got to buy this one. They'd take the one the people brought and run it around back and sell it to the next person in line.
Yeah, that was the second thing they were doing. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples remembered that the scripture says, my devotion to your house, O God, burns in me like a fire. The Jewish authorities replied to the question, what miracle can you perform to show us that you have the right to do this? He didn't need to perform any miracle. He's already done it, right? There's a very interesting story. I don't have time to read it now, but was this the only time Jesus cleansed the temple?
No.
When did he cleanse it again?
3 years later.
3 years later, the last day he was in the temple, last day he was in the temple before he was crucified. And what had, do you remember what Ellen White says about their attitude toward his cleansing the temple?
After the first time, they said, he will never do that again.
Yeah. Why did we run? What were we afraid of? There's just one man there. We're never going to let that guy chase us out of there ever again. And what happened? They were in a bigger hurry to get out the second time. Yeah. Well, going back to Nicodemus. In the interview with Nicodemus, Jesus unfolded the plan of salvation and his mission to the world. And none of his subsequent discourses did he explain so fully, step by step, the work necessary to be done in the hearts of all who would inherit the kingdom of heaven. So what's he saying here? Step by step, what's that?
Gradual transformation. Yeah.
Explaining about, obviously we just have a tiny little snippet of the conversation, just kind of an outline. And obviously Jesus was talking step by step here to Nicodemus, an appointed leader of the people. But the leaders of Israel did not welcome the light. Nicodemus hid the truth in his heart, and for 3 years there was little apparent fruit. So why did Jesus call the conversion experience a new birth?
Before you go, I have a question. Where did John get this story?
I'm going to tell you.
Was he part of the small group that was with Jesus, or was this really just Nicodemus and Judas?
Ellen White says, years later, Nicodemus told the story to John, and John wrote it down. John was not there at the time when it happened. We'll see that a little bit later in our study. So why did Jesus call this? I mean, that's a pretty stark thing to say. You have to be born again. Why did Jesus use that expression, do you think? Didn't he want Nicodemus to think that this was a pretty stark change? This is what we call a paradigm shift, right? A completely new way of thinking. Not easy. Perhaps you've seen the bumper sticker which says, born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. What does that mean?
That you may die the first death, the death of this earth, but second time you'll be raised up.
Okay, if you're born just once, you die physically, and then you're going to die.
Second death.
Some people would say the second death. I would say the second death. If you're born twice, you're born physically, and then you're born spiritually, you only die once. You do not experience a second death.
Or none.
Or maybe none. And they may never die. Jesus was trying to teach this Jewish leader that the dry ceremonies that were being practiced in the temple in Jerusalem could no more save one than that serpent of brass that Moses erected in the wilderness. There's an interesting comment here from our Bible study guide. There are similarities between physical and spiritual births. Both mark the beginning of a new life. Also, we produce neither birth ourselves. It's done for us. Every once in a while, I have to, people come in to me and they want this or that or the other thing done for them, and this problem fixes health problem, because I'm a physician, for those of you who may not know. And I say, well, you know, there's a problem. You chose the wrong parents. And they look at me, and I have to explain to them, well, a lot of the things that we inherit are there from the time we're born, and that's the way it is. There's some things you can't change. Well, but there's also an important difference between them, between the first birth, the physical birth, and the spiritual birth. What's the difference? We didn't have any choice about the first birth. We can, however, choose to be born spiritually the second birth. Only those who freely decide to allow the Holy Spirit to generate a new spiritual self within them are born again. God respects our freedom, and although eager to transform us, he does not change us by force. That's in the section for August 3. What's the deal between God and force? Yeah, I can't. It's hard to hear you shaking your head.
God does not force.
It's against his nature, against his character.
Why?
He wants us to choose what is right.
Love does not force.
Yeah.
And you can't choose, make a rational choice under duress. Mm-hmm. Extortion.
Yeah.
Via deception, so far.
Well, think about your own personal experience, and I'm asking you in the audience out there, think about your own personal experience. Did your conversion really change you? Maybe you were raised as an Adventist, like I was. Did you see a real change when you were baptized? Does our church need some really changed people? Nicodemus was definitely changed by his experience with Christ. Look at this further comment from Ellen White. This is Desire of Ages 176, paragraph 2. In the Sanhedrin Council, he, that is Nicodemus, repeatedly thwarted the schemes of the priest to destroy Jesus. Repeatedly, okay? And then she goes on to say, when that midnight council or early morning council, when they called the Sanhedrin together to condemn Jesus, Nicodemus wasn't invited. After the Lord's ascension, when the disciples were scattered by persecution, Nicodemus came boldly to the front. He employed his wealth in sustaining the infant church that the Jews had expected to be blotted out at the death of Jesus. I'm sorry, the death of Christ. In the time of peril, he who had been so cautious and questioning was firm as a rock, encouraging the faith of the disciples and furnishing means to carry forward the work of the gospel. He was scorned and persecuted by those who had paid him reverence in other days. He became poor in this world's goods, yet he faltered not in the faith which had its beginning in that night conference with Jesus. Do you think Nicodemus was there at the Pentecost? Probably so, right? There's one time, very important point, when we know he was there. When was that? Near the end of Christ's life?
At the death.
Yeah. Who took Jesus down from the cross and buried him?
Nicodemus?
Joseph of Arimathea? There's a third person. The disciple John was there. He took Mary away, and because she, of course, was in tears and so forth, falling apart. And he came back, the three of them, Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, also a member of the Sanhedrin, and John the Baptist, took the body down, wrapped it up, prepared it.
John the disciple, she mentioned, instead of John the Baptist.
I'm sorry. Excuse me for misspeaking. John the disciple, and buried him. So, Nicodemus related to John the story of that interview, and by his pen it was recorded for the instruction of millions. The most famous verse in the Bible was one of the verses that John wrote down in as a result of that story many years later. The truths there taught are as important today as they were on that solemn night in the shadowy mountain when the Jewish ruler came to learn the way of life from the lowly teacher of Galilee. What does that tell you?
It seems to me that the high priest in the Sanhedrin, one wonders why they didn't get rid of Nicodemus.
Well, it sounded like they were thinking, working that way because they didn't call him.
On the other hand, if you think about 3 years it took him to come forth, one tends to think that was probably God's plan.
Mm-hmm.
He had worked for Nicodemus down the line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I kind of imagine he had, in the Sanhedrin, he had a lot of questions he probably raised when they made their plans against Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And they probably knew that after a while, and at the end there, he just kind of keep him away.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Had to figure it out.
Yeah. Well, we know that the Holy Spirit is constantly seeking to draw us individually to Christ. We can resist or we can yield. Is there some way to know for sure if you have been born again? We've been asking a lot of tough questions in these last week and this week. These are really potent lessons. Can we know? Can we know about ourselves? Can we know by looking at behavior of someone else? What do you think? I mean, this lesson's claiming that we can, how to be saved last week and then this week, growing in Christ. I mean, isn't that everything we need to know?
By their fruits you shall know them.
Being observed one way or the other.
Mm-hmm. Well, can we see the works, the effects of the Holy Spirit working in our own lives? Well, look at a couple of verses. Does this give us a clue? Remember, Jesus in his Sermon on the Mount starts out by giving basically the Beatitudes, and he gets down very soon after that in verse 16. In the same way, your light must shine before people so that they will see the good things you do and praise your Father in heaven. What is Jesus suggesting there? That's not too difficult, is it?
Good things that you do.
Mm-hmm.
What could that mean?
Well, yeah. Well, and think about it. How often do you know an experience where someone you know or yourself does something good and someone praises God? How often does that happen? Isn't that what's supposed to happen, according to that verse? Well, Jesus over at the end of his sermon, the end of chapter 7, or near the end of it, says, and starting with verse 15, be on your guard against false prophets. They come to you looking like sheep on the outside, but on the inside they're really like wild wolves. You will know them by what they do. How are you supposed to know them? By what they do. Thorn bushes do not bear grapes, and briars do not bear figs. A healthy tree bears good fruit, but a poor tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a poor tree cannot bear good fruit. And any tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then, you will know the false prophets by what they do. Does that suggest that we might be able to know somebody by what kind of results they produce?
Think so.
When our lives are transformed and we determine to choose God's way instead of our own way, giving up our selfishness as our guiding motive, exchanging it for God's love, there is an unmistakable behavior change in us. You believe that?
Well, it's a little difficult. How do you know if you're not making that change? You know, for outside show,
mm-hmm.
versus something that's really happening inside.
You mean you could deceive yourself?
Well, could deceive a lot of people.
Including ourselves.
Mm-hmm. How fast does this change usually happen in people's lives?
How long did it take Nicodemus?
Yeah. Yeah. Usually these kind of changes happen gradually and very subtly. But how often do we need to work on it?
All the time.
Every day. Now I'd like to ask you a question. And this is a tough one. I would like to ask you in the audience out there as well. What would happen if we as Seventh-day Adventists did a spiritual experiment? What if each day we actually did something for someone else around us that required self-denial on our part and showed loving care for that other person? What do you think would happen?
It would be an example.
Well, doing something nice for the drunk who's standing on the corner and asking for money.
But doing the dishes for your wife. That would be a good start.
Okay, doing the dishes for your wife, that sounds like a good idea.
I like a good idea.
Now, let's not go too far, Gary.
Well, we got to start somewhere, right?
You're fanatic.
You have to be careful, you might need a license.
Well, I mean, think about it. Would people be amazed? Would they be puzzled?
certainly catch their attention.
Well, they wonder what had happened to you.
Maybe.
We need to develop a Christ-likeness habit. What do I mean by that? Well, let's look at another story that Jesus uses. This is John chapter 15. I'm going to start with verse 1. This is Jesus talking, and this is as he's, Ellen White suggests that he actually had left the upper room, and he's walking toward the Garden of Gethsemane, and he passes a vine growing alongside the road. He stops and he looks at the vine and says, I am the real vine, and my Father is the gardener. He breaks off every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and he prunes every branch that does bear fruit. Do you think it's comfortable to be pruned?
Yeah. Not for the branch.
So that it will be clean and bear more fruit. You have been made clean already by the teaching I have given you. Remain united with me, and I will remain united to you. A branch cannot bear fruit by itself. It can do so only if it remains in the vine. In the same way, you cannot bear fruit unless you remain in me. Okay, let's stop there for a second. What does that mean?
You have to have the connection to the source in order to bear fruit.
Okay, what do you think bearing fruit means?
That's producing. I mean,
spreading the word.
What if
a tomato plant doesn't produce any tomatoes, is it a tomato plant?
Well, it's not worth much.
Yeah.
We had a tomato plant once. It grew a huge plant, didn't have one tomato on it. One year. That was really strange. But that was a disappointment.
Uh-huh. Okay. What does it mean to bear fruit? Now, there's two ways that this has usually been interpreted. One way is bearing fruit means you spread the gospel to somebody else. The other way is that bearing fruit means there's a change in your life, so you behave differently. Do you think it includes both of those things? Probably. Jesus goes on, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. Can do nothing? What does that mean?
Well, you can't bear any fruit if you're not connected to the roots.
Whoever does not remain in me is thrown out like a branch and dries up. Such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire where they are burnt. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you will ask for anything you wish and you shall have it. My Father's glory is shown by your bearing much fruit. And in this way you become my disciples. I love you just as the Father loves me, remaining in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. What's Jesus suggesting here? Is he really trying to say that we could have the same kind of relationship to him as he has with the Father?
Take instructions. That's what he's doing. He follow my commands.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a harsh way of saying, but really is what he's trying to do is teach.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't want to listen, you're not going to learn.
I think one thing it's saying that if you don't feel like doing anything good for anybody, it'd be a good time to pray to get whatever you need inside you so you can do it.
Okay. You want to say that? In other words, I'm not sure I followed all that.
Well, say that, you just encouraged everybody to try an experiment. Go out and try to do something good for someone.
Right.
But you go home and you don't feel like doing that. You never feel like doing that. You just can't seem to do that experiment. I mean, the first thing you do is you pray about it.
Mm-hmm.
So something's got to come.
Let's be very honest about this. Does doing something really nice for somebody else, which is a sacrifice for us, does that come naturally for selfish human beings?
No.
It doesn't. So it means that at the beginning, at least, we're going to have to do what? we're going to have to do something that we don't really want to do, right? Now, how does that become, how does something we don't really want to do become something we want to do? By practice. By practice.
You've had it long enough, you might use some talents you never knew you had or realized you had.
I don't know, though. I think it's possible to, if there's something you don't want to do, that all of a sudden, someday, you might want to do it.
Yeah.
And it may come in, the Spirit might just fall on you that day, and you may want to do it that time, and that's kind of an answer to prayer right there.
Well, you might, yeah, exactly. But you might also do it and discover that the results are wonderful and that it was the right thing to do.
I had an experience this morning, just driving on the freeway. My personality changes when I get behind the wheel.
I see.
And my kids will attest to it. I have a hard time, you know, not wanting to keep up with the other car or let, you know, if somebody starts to cut me off, you know, or whatever. And this morning I thought, okay, this is not a big deal. I should just let this, you know, be. And I thought, I can't do this. I can't. I've tried over and over. And I said the prayer. I said, please help me to be a better citizen. I mean, and when you find out that that person that you're competing with or that you're cutting off is somebody you know, oh my, things change.
Okay.
Especially when it's your husband, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. It goes on here. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My commandment is this, love one another just as I love you. The greatest love a person can have for his friends is to give his life for them. And you are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer because servants do not know what their master is doing. Instead, I call you friends because I have told you everything I've heard from my Father. That's a very interesting conclusion to that discussion.
He's teaching. He's been teaching.
Yeah.
It's what he's doing. It's all teaching.
It's interesting in a society that is repeatedly and continually and growing and downing Christianity, when it comes down to Memorial Day, the text is brought up, greater love hath no man.
Yeah.
Strange, isn't it?
Well, we've got something serious to think about now. We as Seventh-day Adventists have been preaching the second coming of Christ for almost 170 years since the Great Disappointment in October of 1844. It's 2014, almost 170 years. What would happen if we individually behaved as if Christ is coming again very soon? Could we learn to behave in very Christian ways all day long and not just during morning prayers and evening devotion? And what difference would that make in our world?
I wonder if you could put it like, what if more people prayed that this would happen to them?
Okay.
And to make sure that the Spirit comes down with the power to do it.
That would certainly be a good start, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. I think to say the least, we'd make our presence felt a little more than we do.
Jesus planned every day of his life, especially during his ministry, with his Father and the Holy Spirit. He was in constant communication with them. Could we develop that kind of a habit? I think we could.
What does that mean? When you accomplish that, what do you think it is?
I think it means that all day long we do what God wants us to do. We represent him correctly. I think that's what Jesus did.
That you represent him correctly.
Mm-hmm.
You got to have to kind of think about God to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
So if it gets to dinner time and you sit down and have prayer, have the blessing, and you find out that was the first time you thought about God all day, I think maybe you've blown it.
Yeah.
Better then than never, though.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. At the blessing of the food, but still.
Well, we would need to spend more time focusing on the Bible and Bible study and prayer. More than that, in order to cement in our minds our understanding of the truths with which God has blessed us, we need to practice explaining those truths to others. That's not easy, you know. The people who are out there in the world, we tend not to want to talk to them about religion. But God says that's witnessing. That's part of our growing in Christ. Witnessing is one of the greatest ways to discover how much we do or do not know about our own beliefs. And if we take that approach to forming a more direct and full association of faith with Jesus Christ, he responds by saying, "Ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you." Matthew 7:7. Does that prayer sound a little selfish to you?
Taken out of context, just that, yes.
How many Christians down through the generations have said, "God, I'm asking, now you promised you're going to give me the new car I want," or whatever it happens to be.
"I'm asking and you promised."
Yeah. Isn't that what it seems to say? Ask and it will be given to you.
Well, according to the will of God. But you know, I worked in Pathfinders before.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them would get down and pray for things that I would have freaked out over, and they did it. Well, like one person lost a key way out in the field somewhere,
mm-hmm.
and they said, "We got to get together and pray about this." And all the kids did that, and they prayed. And what would you think if they were praying for that key that's way out in the big football field somewhere that they lost?
Mm-hmm.
Then they would run out after a while. Here it is. I mean, it's just amazing. It's pretty incredible. Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Well, Christ was offering to help us spread the gospel to others so it can be finished. This is not a prayer so we can live lives of luxury sitting back and doing nothing. So how should we pray? The disciples asked that question of Jesus, and of course he responded with what we call the Lord's Prayer. Look at Matthew 6:9-13. What kind of things are we supposed to ask for? "Then this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored." What's the first thing we need to pray for? That God's name be honored. How can we help God's name to be honored?
That we not misrepresent him, that we do what's right.
A few verses before this, we talked about earlier, Matthew 5:16, we're supposed to do good things so that people will praise the Father in heaven, right? Mm-hmm. So when we say, "May your holy name be honored," what we're saying is, "God, will you please help me to do things that will help your name to be honored," right? "May your kingdom come. Hasten the second coming. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Help me to do your will today," right? "Give us today the food we need. Forgive us the wrongs we have done as we forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Do not bring us to hard testing, but keep us safe from the evil one." Those are pretty practical things, right? Very practical. But there are certain conditions to be met when we pray. We must believe that God can answer us. Look at Matthew 21:22. "If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask in prayer." If you believe. In other words, if you ask in faith, right? We must believe that God can, we must be willing to open our hearts up not only to God above us, but also to our neighbors around us. Mark 11:25, and I quote, "And when you stand and pray, forgive anything you may have against anyone, so that your Father in heaven will forgive the wrongs you have done." Suggesting that there's a bit of a reciprocal process going on here. And we must always be willing to pray according to God's will. Look at Luke 22:42. Father, he said, if you will, take this cup of suffering away from me, not my will, however, but your will be done. Where was Jesus when he prayed that prayer?
Garden of Gethsemane.
And he was talking about giving his life, wasn't he? Despite our best intentions, not everything we pray for, even in spreading the gospel, will be answered at just the time and in just the way we think best. Why not?
Well, sometimes what you ask for is not good for you.
Yeah. When we say, God, you need to do it my way, what are you really saying?
Negating what we just mentioned further back.
Yeah, implying that I know better about what should happen right now than God does. I mean, how incredibly egotistical can we be? Jesus told his disciples, Luke 18, verse 1, Jesus told his disciples a parable to teach them that they should always pray and never become discouraged. Okay? Well, look at Luke 9, 23 and 24. And he said to them, anyone who wants to come with me must forget self, take up their cross every day and follow me. For whoever wants to save their own life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for my sake will save it. Doesn't that sound like a oxymoron? How can you say, give it up so you save it, and save it so you lose it? Mm-hmm. Is living this new kind of life going to be easy? Jesus told us to take up our crosses. Now, you know, we've gotten to the place where we think a cross is almost glorious, you know, symbol of something good. What did it mean in Jesus' day?
The very opposite.
You have done the worst possible thing you can do in the Roman government. You're a traitor to the government. You need to be tortured and killed in the worst possible way. And that's the cross. Okay? So, why is it that we must die to self in order to truly live? Does that make any sense?
Because if we don't lose self, I mean, we're selfish. We are a selfish human. Mm-hmm. We have to lose that self.
What was Paul trying to tell us in Galatians 2, verse 20? I have been crucified with Christ. So that it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. This life that I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave his life for me. And the crucified with Christ is actually the verse before that. Let me just read that. So far as the law is concerned, however I am dead, killed by law itself in order that I might live for God. I have been put to death with Christ on his cross, so that it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. Okay. You need to read the whole sentence there. I started in the middle of the sentence. We are born with an incredible drive for self-preservation. Think of a little baby. It's amazing what they will go through just to get what they need, the noise they'll make, whatever. As we grow, that desire usually, unfortunately, turns into selfishness. And it requires an incredible amount of determination to overcome that inherent selfishness in us. And I have some quotations here. No man can empty himself of self. We can only consent for Christ to accomplish the work. Then the language of the soul will be, Lord, take my heart, for I cannot give it. It is thy property. Keep it pure, for I cannot keep it for thee. Save me in spite of myself, my weak, unchristlike self. Mold me, fashion me, raise me into a pure and holy atmosphere where the rich current of thy love can flow through my soul. It is not only at the beginning of the Christian life that this renunciation of self is to be made. At every advanced step heavenward, it is to be renewed. Only by constant renunciation of self and dependence on Christ can we walk safely. Christ's Object Lessons, page 159 and 160. When was the last time you died to self? Don't want anybody to speak up too loud here. Can you tell when you die to self? You know, I thought we ought to look at some real, quote, real potent statements here. The warfare against self is the greatest battle that was ever fought. Tell the people who fought in the Battle of the Bulge or some of those other battles that. The warfare against self is the greatest battle that was ever fought. The yielding of self, surrendering all to the will of God, requires a struggle. But the soul must submit to God before it can be renewed in holiness. Steps to Christ, page 43, paragraph 3. Then, elsewhere, this is in Heavenly Places, 155, paragraph 3. We cannot retain our own self and be filled with the fullness of God. We must be emptied of self. If heaven is gained by us at last, it will be only through the renunciation of self and in receiving the mind, the spirit, and the will of Christ Jesus. Wow. So why are we called to deny self daily? If we do not deny self and if we allow self to dominate all that we think or do, what kind of lives would we live? Would our lives in any way resemble that of our Master? Not hardly, huh? What does your answer tell you about yourself apart from Christ? Will there be any selfish people in heaven? If not, shouldn't we start practicing now? I mean, you know, think about it. Is it appropriate to start practicing to live in heaven if we're planning to be there pretty soon? Now, if we're not planning to go to heaven for another 1,000 years, then maybe we can delay a little bit. But no human being is going to live that long, so not in this world. So even if we thought Jesus wasn't coming for a long time, we still should be practicing. We need to actually begin practicing, living the kind of lives we really believe we will be living when we get to heaven. What difference would that kind of behavior make in your life and in the life of the people who attend your church? Think about it.